Thank you for watching this video. If you're a subscriber, sure do appreciate it. If not, consider doing so. And don't forget to give this video a thumbs up. Well, everybody, welcome back to the shop, and we're just about getting to the end of all the major parts of the little 10V engine. There's really only one more major part that needs to be made, or at least I think it is. I haven't gone back through and checked off all the plans, but in my head, I kind of keep track of where I am in the project, and that's this piece right here, and this is the eccentric connecting rod. Now, the eccentric, what it does, it's, and this is it right here, and if you look at it, you can notice that the hole has been drilled off-center or bored off-center. Well, what that will do is, this attaches to the crankshaft of the steam engine, and as it turns or rotates on the crankshaft, it will actually, I got some stuff in my hand here, it will actually move this piece here up and down. So it's taking the eccentric is what changes the rotary motion into some linear motion as it goes up and down on the steam engine. Now it doesn't go up much. As I recall, there's only about 3/16 of an inch throw. Now you come to a decision that you make when you make little engines. And there's a lot of different ways you can go. Some ways some people will frown at, some people snub their nose up at, but it's like the car hobbyist. And I, in fact, I'm an old wrench twister from way back. And I know when you're talking about restoring cars, you get all these different points and everything. And that means you've gone back where all the numbers match on your engine. And you've gone back and you've got the original this and the original that, and it's the exact safety wire that was on it, and it was exactly this. And when you get through, you've got a 100% old restored car. Same thing when you're building scale models. There's a difference between a semi-scale model, a scale model, and a realistic model. The scale model would mean everything about the full-size part that you're modeling is exactly the same thing except in miniature. A semi-scale model would say, you know, we've taken a few liberties here and there, but we haven't faithfully followed the exact blueprint. We've made some minor modifications. Some were perhaps ease of building the part, could be lack of available materials and so forth. And then there's the realistic version of that. Now, all three of those take the same amount of skill level. Well, maybe the scale would perhaps take a little bit more because you're really getting down to the nuts and bolts of that. Well, why talk about all that? Well, because here's the reason. What I'm building here is a model of a real engine. And this is modeled off of an engine over in England. And the plans that are with the engine pretty well faithfully reproduce that engine in a very smaller scale. Even said this engine would still be semi-scale. It's not scaled down everything. Some things are larger in proportion, some things are smaller, some things are left out, and so forth like that. The way I am approaching this, I want this to be a realistic looking engine. I'm not after scale entity as far as the right paint job goes. I'm not after everything is scaled down to every little nut and bolt as if a true rendition of a scale model would be. I'm really not even doing a semi-scale model. I'm kind of a little bit past semi-scale into realistic. Now, I tell you why I said all that is because I'm going to build this part and deviate from the plan just a little bit. And I'm going to show you how I'm going to do that. And at the end of it, this part is going to look exactly like the scale engine, but it's going to be built completely different. That's the beauty of having a home machine shop. Hey, it's your time and it's your project. You can build it like you want it. Come over, join me over here at the bench, and I'll show you how we're going to make this into a realistic but not scale eccentric rod. All right, well, what am I about to do here? Well, let me show you. If you look at this plan right here, this shows where this part has been split in the middle. and it's been bolted together. In other words, you could approach this just like I did the crankshaft, where you split it first, then go back and bore. Don't bore, then split, because you will not have a round hole when you do that. What this is, and there's the eccentric piece right there, and that will rotate around here. If you look at what's going on here, and I'll draw this, if you come around the bottom of this, actually, that eccentric has got a groove that goes all the way around in there. And what happens at the bottom of this, and you can see it right there, there is a bolt, and I'll try to draw the bottom of this thing right here. And up here, there's a little bolt that comes in, and this rides in there, and that keeps the cam here from falling out. So what I'm going to do, and I've done it before, this is a sliding fit in there, or a running fit. This is a running fit. It's not a tight fit. It's a running fit, same as your crankshaft is. What I'm going to do is, I'm going to go to the forejaw, and I'm going to mount this in the forejaw. This part right here will be bored to fit the eccentric. Then, what I will do, while it's in the forejaw, I will come across with the lathe tool, and I will score that just like that. It'll be perfectly on center. I'll also go to the side and score that way and score that way. Then what I'll do is just come in and tap a little small hole, not very deep at all, but I will tap for a machine bolt to go in there. In other words, the side of it, I'll come down here. Here's the side. The shaft comes down, and I'm just going to draw it like that. And in the middle of it here is this hole. All right, that's going to be a fake. That's a fake. And then it'll be a little machine screw, a machine bolt, just barely on top, and put in there with Loctite. Yes, it will not be scale, and it's not full-size design. If it were a full-size engine, this would have bushings in it and everything else. That's what I'll say. This is not a scale engine, because if it were a scale engine, this thing would have bushings all the way in it. It would have bearings. It would have everything in it. It'd have Babbitt bearings. So there's no way this is going to be a scale engine. This is going to be the effective look, or it will effectively look as if it is a two-piece. Let's go to the lathe, put it up in the forejaw, and see how well we get along. Okay, well, as you can see, I am not at the lathe. I'm back at the mill drill here. And that's the old saying, the best laid plans. And theoretically, that should have worked pretty good at the forejaw. But when I went over there to put it in the forejaw, it was kind of goofy getting set up and everything. And I thought, you know what, by the time I get the thing set up and centered in the forejaw, I could just get it done over here at the milling machine. Now, what I'm using here is just one of those little inexpensive boring bars. The way it works is you tighten up the slide on this side right here, and it's got a little dial that moves this part in and out. So, they're not that hard to get centered, and you can center it by eye. And again, I keep saying these are excellent forgings and castings, but even a good forging and casting, you still have to kind of swag it just a little bit to get the thing in center. And what I do is I just bring this tip right here, the cutting tip, out as far as I can until it just kisses the outside edge when I put it in there as I turn it around by hand. So I've got that, and it's touching just on one little bitty teeny side. Actually, I can probably move it in just a little bit more like that. And then I just keep turning it, bringing it out until I can hear a drag all the way around. Now, I'm not going to do all that on the camera, but I'll come back when I get it pretty equal all the way around. Okay, I've got it set to where it's just got a a drag as it goes all the way across from one side to the other. I've measured it. I've got to bore that out to 625 thousandths. The first thing I'm going to do is trim up the inside of that where the forging went in and did the stamping. It's a little bit deformed right there on the inside. I'm just going to clean that up just a little bit. Then I'll go in and then I'll take a real good measurement of that. Now, these things are, they're not fast, especially when you've got little small cuts like that that you're trying to make. Because every time you got to do it, I've got to do exactly what you're seeing here. I've got to cut the machine off, let it stop, undo the dovetail, loosen it up, back it up about 10 thousandths, then start the whole thing over again. And it just takes just a second to go down there and cut it. And then it's just repetitious, one after the other. And I did that one in real time so that you'll see what needs to be done. Then you got to come back over here, bring it out about another 10 thousandths, bring it over, tighten it, then you just do the whole thing over and over till you get 625 thousandths. That was a perfect cut. I just barely heard that as it went through. Just barely heard it. Oh yeah, that's what I'm looking for. Fall through. Now, the next thing is I'm going to put that slit across there to give the appearance that that has been cut in two. Okay, now you're wondering how I'm going to put that line across there to make it look like it's in two pieces. Well, I'm going to show you. What I've done is that's just a piece of drill rod. It hasn't been hardened or anything. It's just got a 60 degree point on it and made in the lathe. And again, hasn't been hardened, but this is brass, so I shouldn't have any problem scoring it. So I'm going to just put that in the middle of that hole, and the way I'm going to do that is come back. You won't be able to see it on the camera, but I'm going to set the table at zero. And then I'm just going to see how far it's going to take it to get to the other side. Well, I need to take up travel. All right, so now I'm in the middle of that hole, and by now you can probably figure out what I'm going to do. I'm going to come over here, come down on that, and then I'm just going to scratch it easily all the way across. And it's just going to cut into it as it goes across, and it's going to give the appearance that there was a slot in there. Need to come down just a little bit more on that one. And that's it. Alrighty. Now I can take that out. And I don't know if you're able to see that or not, but that has the appearance of a slot that's in there, and I'll take it over there in just a little bit and actually cut it a little bit groove in there. It won't be very much, just a little small groove. Then just put some false heads on it and we're ready to go. And we don't lose that piece right there. Then the eccentric will go in here. Oh, let me get it from the other side so it works good. Well, I've got to go deburr. It's got a burr on it. There, it's kind of going in right now. It's got a big burr on that side. I've got to go move that. All right, let's go back to the workbench. Okay, I've just completed, or at least as far as I'm going to go until I get to final assembly on the eccentric rod. Now, I've still got to go over there and drill a hole, but I'm not going to drill that hole until I make sure that the top part up in here with that valve chest and everything, that I've got it all lined out before I actually drill the hole that will need to be drilled in there. But that's just a simple matter of punching that through. So, and I'll go back and I'll clean this up, but I've got my marker line for that. And I'll come back after I finish the engine and after I get it run in to just drill a hole. It'll be a clearance hole, and I'll just Loctite a couple of bolt heads on there. The only part that I did not show
was this little screw, which is this little part right here on the plan. And I had to put it in the lathe. It's a little small turning job, but there's just a little small tit on the end of that that will ride up inside the groove on the eccentric. That's this part right there that I was talking about. So this will screw in from the bottom. Now, everything has not been run in, and everything is still dry. So it's pretty tight getting together. We're going to put this in, and I've still got some burrs I've got to go back and reburr. But it's kind of getting cold out here in the shop. I need to get on in the house. It's almost supper time. And put this in here like that. And that will screw in once that gets started. And then that holds that in place. And then you've got an eccentric that will go round and round and round and round. So that's how you build the eccentric and the eccentric rod for the Stuart 10V engine. And that, actually, that's not tight enough. I need to go back in and do a little more tightening on that. But I've got some more deburring to do. But like I say, it's getting late in the evening, and my wife has got supper ready, and I'm getting cold. Guys, we'll see you on the next video. Thanks for watching.